Good morning, students. Welcome in this class. This is class 8, subject social science, and today we are here to discuss history chapter first, how, when, and where. And this is the first lecture of this chapter. Actually, students, that most of the students considered history as a boring subject. Okay, yes or no? I think you also, many are there out of you, those who think that history is just boring and consider that it is just about memorizing date. But beta, today in this chapter we will discuss that why we study history and why it is so important to remember the dates and the happening of past of the different parts of the world. Okay, so let's start our chapter. Yes, before starting the chapter, I want to tell something, give some introductions about your book. As you see your book, on your book, on the cover page of your book, it is written history or past third. So what is the meaning of this, ki our past third? Actually, beta, according to the curriculum of your, that history is divided into the three parts, ancient, medieval, and modern. So in six standards, you have read about the ancient history, means past one, our past one. And in seventh standard, you have studied about the medieval period, our past two. And now you are in 8th standard, and in this class you will study about the third part of the history, means our past third, and that is modern period. In ancient period you have studied about the India under the rulers and their kingdoms, means when India was ruled by Indian rulers. And medieval period means when the you can say the Muslims or the Mughal rulers came in India and ruled over it. And the third period is there, beta, modern period. This is the time when Britishers came and settled in India, and they brought changes in everything, means they set up new rules, regulations, policy, and new administration system, and they brought the changes in every system, agriculture, trading, means everything they have changed according to their comfort. So now in this class, or means in history, you will study about all the modern periods, or means the situation or condition of the Indians in India under the British rule. So understood? Yes. Now our question is there, that how important are dates? Yes, beta, have you ever thought why the dates are so important? Yes, remembering dates is not an easy job. Everybody accept it, kinda it is not so easy to remember dates. So moreover, it is not even an interesting task for many of us. But have you ever thought why we need to remember dates, or why we should study history? Well, yes, anything which we see happening in our surrounding must have begun on some day. For example, we drink tea or coffee, but how did it become part of our dietary habit? And when it first came into use by man? Not only this, we all must have traveled by train. So when did trains start in India? Such questions take us back to the notion of date and time, but time is not always precise. Sometimes we even do not know about the exact date or time of the particular happening. Means why we can't fix a particular date? We can't fix a particular date for any event because many of the things happen over a stretch of time. We know that Britishers came to India in 1608. And then they started ruling India from 1757. But do we know the exact date of the year 1757 on which they started ruling? No. Similarly, if we move back to the example of tea which I have given to you, that do we know the exact date on which Indians started drinking tea? No. That is why it is not possible to fix date or for each and every event. Okay, beta. So now the question, so why do we associate with dates with history? It is because in early times the court historians used to record only the crucial event of a king's life, such as that his kingdom time and his misruling time, his marriage and the battle fought by him. So now know why dates are important. Actually, earlier time we say beta in previous history that means previously history was account of battles and big events such as means in the past historians just focused on the special events of the means a particular king and their achievements. This is their like they focus on the year when we king of a particular area was crowned, the year he was married and had a child, the year he died, and the year the next ruler succeeded to the throne. But after some times the concept or means the thinking of the historian changed. Now the historians focused on the event ki how the things were in the past and how they have changed in the present. This is there. Understood about it? Means and with a date does not become important if something big happened on the day in the past, but it gains its significance on the basis of how much need we are to study the events which happened during a particular times. So Miss Vita, here question is there that which dates are important? Yes, dates become important when historians focus on a particular set of event. What does it mean? Like here I'll explain this in tense with an example. By giving an example, suppose everybody knows or remember well about his birthday date. I think now everyone, you also know about your birthday date and never you forget. Why? Because this is the important event in your life. On this particular date, the great event means you took birth. This is there. So means that's why this date become important for you. So now I think beta you understood that means dates are not important, but the events are important, and events, special events on a particular date are there which make any date important for us. This is there. Yes, means second, if the focus of study changes, a new set of dates will appear significant. What does it mean? Means if our focus changes, the importance of date also changes. Let's take an example. Here I also have given one example. In Indian history written by British historians, the rule of each governor general was important. Actually, the British historians began their history with the first governor general of Bengal, Warren Hastings. But you must know about it. कि the first governor general of India was Warren Hastings, and it continues up to the last viceroy in of India, and he was Lord Mountbatten. So you must know about these two person, like first governor general of India Warren Hastings and last viceroy of India Lord Mountbatten. Their history mainly focuses on the activities, policies and their lifestyle of these men. It does not talk about anything else. Here, what I wanted to say is that some other events were also happening at that time in India within the society, but nothing was put on record for them. What does it mean? If you see that records of the British historians, then you found good amount of record of the ruling of Governor General. So it's saying that why that only these things are important, because historians at that time focused on only activities of Governor General, but it doesn't mean that at that time no other activities were going on. Yes, other activities were also taking place, but why they are not important? Because historian didn't focus on them. So what is the meaning of this? That when any person focused on any event, then it becomes important. Yes, so since now we can or miss find that we have to write it in a sequence so that it not only sounds like a story but also the one with senses. Means that's why miss all the events are writing in a sequence, miss like a story, to create interest. Okay, and when there is a great changes occurred in the society, then means the period is divided on this basis. means when the great changes occurred in the society, the time period is different. Time period is given or different name is given to that time period. So on this basis of the changes occurred in the society, that Indian history is divided into three parts. And the first time Indian history was divided by James Mill in 1817. And he was a Scottish economist, and he published a book named A History of British India, and in which he divided the history into three periods, that was Hindus, Muslim and British. Yes, so but this division is not accepted by all. Actually, many problems lie with this division of James Mill. First, this division was based on the religious line. What does it mean? History was divided into three categories, namely Hindu, Muslim and British, on the basis of the rulers of different periods. According to Mill, all Asian societies, like in his division, he described Asians to have poorly civilized. Means according to Mill, all Asian societies were not at lower level. All societies were at lower level than the European civilization. Means according to him, Hindu and Muslim rulers had ruled India, and there was huge intolerance against the religion of each other. Some social evils were also presented, such as caste system, superstitious, many beliefs, all there. And according to him, it was necessary to introduce European education and manners to them for their upliftment. Yes. So do you think that such an idea can be accepted? Yes. First of all, we cannot categorize Indian history as totally a Hindu history or a Muslim history, as rulers from both the religions had ruled with the same period of time. This is there. And moreover, many of other faiths also existed in the India in the same times with Hindu and Muslim religion, and they were practicing their faith freely. First thing is there, that means both Hindu and Muslims are misruled at the same times. And it was not only there that only these two main religion were presented in the society at that time, but along with it, Hindu and Muslim religion, other religions also were there, like Buddhism, Jainism, and these people were also practiced their custom freely. So moving away from this British classification, the historians have divided Indian history into ancient, medieval and modern. So when this division was not accepted, when another division of the Indian history was done, and this was the history is divided into three periods, and it was ancient, medieval and modern. But the categorizations also has some problem. But this categorization is also not so much, means you can say, popular, because many problems lie with this division also. And actually what is there, generally when we talk about the first two parts are okay, ancient and medieval, no problem in this. But the problem lies with the third period, that is modern period. And what is there with that? Actually, when we talk about the modern period, so generally when we talk about modern period, it denotes the growth of science and technology, and also is freedom and liberty. But as I told you, that modern period is the period when India was under the British rule. And as we know that under the British rules, Indians were not given equality, freedom. Okay, so okay, when the people did not have equality or freedom, so how can we say them that it is the modern period? That why it is also not accepted. This is there. Okay, yes. Now problems with this division also, like I told, it is borrowed from the West, means the Britishers follow the same procedure which they adopted in their own country. And in modern period, features of modern society did not exist, which I already told you. So which is the feature of modern society, like freedom, equality, this is there. And these things were not given to the Indian under the British rules. And many historians refer British rule period as colonial period. Okay, and what is this colonial period? and about all these we will discuss in our next lecture. So in this way, today explanation is completed. Now I'll assign you some homework, question answer as homework based on this topic. First question is there, name the first Governor General of India. During explanation I told this name of the person, and name the book published by James Mill. What was the Mill's opinion about the Asian societies? And what is the problem with the periodizations of Indian history that James Mill offers? So you have to do this question answer, and if you face any problem, then tomorrow we will discuss answer of these questions. Okay, beta. Now we will discuss about the question solutions of our chapter 2, lecture 4, geography. And in which first question is, how is vegetation useful to us? Vegetation serves several important functions in the biosphere. Yes, like vegetation help in prevention of soil erosion. It provides oxygen for breathing. It helps in storage underground water. And in coastal areas, they act as shelter belt. So during the explanation, I told the meaning of shelter belt. It is practiced in the coastal areas where winds blow with great speed. To check the movement of the wind, plants or trees are planted in a row. Vegetation provides shelter to wild animals also. Now our next question is, differentiate between evergreen and deciduous forest. Yes students, evergreen trees do not shed their leaves at a particular season. Means in evergreen forest, trees do not shed their leaves at particular season and they remain green throughout the year. Trees are very dense, means very close to each other, and these forests are found where rain is more than 200 cm, and these types of forests are found in the rainy slopes of Western Ghat, plains of West Bengal, Odisha and northeastern India. Yes, now the deciduous forest, these trees, missing this forest, trees shed their leaves in a particular season, particular time, and in this forest trees are not so close, not so dense, and they are found where the rain is about between 75 to 200 cm, and found in the eastern slopes of Western Ghat, Chota Nagpur Plateau. And the example of the trees which are found in this forest are oak and bamboo. Now next question, mention some measures taken by our government to conserve wildlife and natural vegetation. Yes, but this is your NCERT book question. Yes, government has set up national park, wildlife sanctuaries to conserve natural vegetation and wildlife. Yes, illegal hunting and poaching is also banned in India. And site, this is a program. I told you about this program during explanation. Given program has been established that lists several species of animals and birds in which trade of animals and birds is prohibited. Means according to that, a list of the many or several animals and birds which trade is prohibited. Understood? So in this way, our today's lecture is completed, and tomorrow we will meet again with our next lecture. Thank you.